I think I did greet everybody, but welcome again. Just a few announcements. There has been a change in October 20th will be the Pastor Appreciation Sunday, and I think we have something special going on probably that day. Please join us immediately following the worship. I think that we're going to have something that day, aren't we too, Kathy? Food-wise?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And I'd like to remind the men about the men's club. Last month, we decided, Windsor and I decided not to have it because nobody else came. So we met in the parking lot, and we departed from the parking lot. Went home, and I think Merrill made Windsor breakfast. Right? And I went home and had my berries with my cereal. What was the other one? I think that was it. Everything else is kind of old news, except under the list for the Friends of Trinity, it's expanding quite a bit, so check over the list. If you have somebody on there that you know the name could be removed, talk to Nicole. Okay.
Thank you.
please join me in the call to worship. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We proclaim your name to the whole human family. We praise you in the midst of this congregation. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Let us praise our majestic Creator all this day long as we gather before his holy table this Sabbath morning. Amen. Now please join me in the call to confession. When we reflect on the goodness and majesty of God, we cannot help but recognize our own mortal frailty and failing. And yet God cares for us. Emboldened by God's love, we can be honest in confession. Assured already of God's grace, let us confess together. Sovereign God, who are we humans that you pay any attention to us? And yet you have entrusted us to care for all of creation. We confess the times we have thought too highly of ourselves and the ways we have twisted our charge to care for creation into permission to dominate and subdue it. We confess the same human tendency and dominate and subdue our other people. It is nor or take for granted our own privilege. Your desire is for peace, but so often we choose comfort and call it peace. Remind us of who we are and whose we are. Remind us of our interdependence with creation and our dependence on you, our Creator. Set our hearts and minds on your will, made known to us in Jesus Christ. Amen. Now please take a time for silence and observe your personal confession.
My dear and good friends, hear the good news. The one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all children of one God. Jesus is not ashamed to call us his beloved children and family. Our sin is forgiven, and we are made one with Christ and with each other. Thanks be to God. Amen. Seated. Well, likewise, I also take this moment in God's time to bid each and every one of you welcome to Trinity Presbyterian Church this morning, particularly as we draw together before the Lord's table in what is known as Worldwide Communion Sunday. It is an honor and a privilege for all of us to come before his table at this particular time on our liturgical calendar. I'm happy to report that although you don't see her up front this morning, my wife Karen is back, feeling much better. She's sitting way back there, I think in the rear pew, refreshed and renewed from our recent trip to Europe. At the same time and in the same breath, I should also point out that oh, woe and alas, we're going to be taking off again right after church this morning to attend a continuing education event in South Carolina, the state of South Carolina. For those of you who might not be aware of it, Presbyterian ministers are pretty much required to attend a continuing education events over the course of their career. And I'll be honest with all of you, over the past 5 years, I have not attended a single continuing education course. So it's about time that I do something about it in order to kind of keep up with what's happening out there in the theological realm. The good news is one of my former professors, Professor John Burgess of Pittsburgh Theological Seminary, will be the featured speaker at this event. He's a highly respected theologian in the arena of what is called systematic theology. And as you can imagine, I keenly look forward to hearing what he has to offer this coming week. As I look across the face of the congregation this morning, I'm not sure that we have any of our wee young ones here. Are they all back in school? They must all be back in school. Well, be that as it may, dear friends, let us turn to hymn selection number 262 entitled God of the Ages, Whose Almighty Hand. And will you stand with me as we sing this together? Seated. It's one of my all-time favorite hymns. It's majestic, powerful. What a marvelous way to praise God as we come together on Worldwide Communion Sunday. Well, my dear friends, as we draw together this morning, let us take a moment to look at one of the early chapters that is revealed to us by way of John's Gospel in the New Testament, chapter 6, verses 35 and then 41 through 51. Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." At this, the Jews began to grumble about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he say, 'I came down from heaven'?" "Stop grumbling among yourselves," Jesus answered. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'They will all be taught by God.' Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Thus ends the reading of his holy word for this morning, and I pray God what is blessing unto it. Amen. I'm willing to bet that a number of you, in fact, perhaps even most of you, over the years have read a publication called the National Geographic. Do any of you have subscriptions? Subscriptions to the National Geographic. Oh my goodness. I can tell I have my work cut out for me already this morning. The National Geographic magazine, that beautiful yellow trimmed, it doesn't ring a bell. The Smithsonian National Geographic. Well, at any rate, for the past 40 years, my wife and I have enjoyed receiving this publication from the National Geographic folks down at the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C. And along with this magazine, they also publish a history magazine on a monthly basis, plus a couple of other journals. When do you know it? Not too long ago, in a relatively recent issue, I learned something fascinating. I learned that a fellow by the name of Dr. Meng Zhu at the University of Connecticut's Center on Aging has found something out regarding his experimentation with, of all things, laboratory mice. Have any of you ever experimented with laboratory mice? Probably not. Well, the thing he's discovered recently is, with a mixture of two different drugs, these drugs apparently kill the sentient cells, the body cells, in elderly mice. That is, of course, the cells that bring about the process of aging. Something that several of us were discussing just prior to church this morning, the process of aging. Well, if this doesn't pique your interest, maybe the next part will. These drugs, according to the good doctor, have been found to give his mice, his laboratory mice, a much more robust constitution, as well as prevent several different types of diseases. And it helps them to live longer. I guess you could say that it's kind of the equivalent of human beings just like us in their 70s and 80s having their lives extended by possibly 5 or 6 years. And what is more, these drugs apparently are safe for human consumption. Maybe I'll send a letter to Dr. Ming Zhu to see if I can acquire some of these special drugs. So I ask you this morning, how about it? If this were on offer for, say, a 10-year extension, a 10-year extension of your life, would you do it? And if the offer were for, oh, say, 50 or 60 years of a life extension, would you still accept it? Moreover, if the offer were for repeated doses so that you could live forever, would you accept it? Tempting, isn't it? I can vividly recall when I was about 13 or 14, someone asked my father, who was a medical doctor, a family medical physician, if he could be any animal, any kind of animal that exists over out here on the planet Earth, what would he be? You know what his response was? I would like to be a turtle. A turtle? Why would you like to be a turtle? And immediately he came back with, because they live so long. Well, these turtles, as we all know, do tend to live an awful long time, 100 years, 150 years, maybe 200. Would we accept an offer if we were given that opportunity to take those, you know, special medications to extend life? Well, it seems to me that apart from anything else, where on earth would we put all the people who decided to live forever? Because after a while, the earth might run out of space, so we would have to send them to the moon or even to the planet Mars. Billions and billions of people living forever. Something to think about. Now, here's another twist on this. Let's take a little adventure into this thing called time and space. Time passed. And again, by way of the National Geographic magazine, highly respected around the face of the world, not long ago, a discovery was made in a place called France, in a cave called the Font du Gaume in the Dordogne region of France. It's sort of located in southwestern France, way back in the middle of nowhere. The National Geographic published photographs of paintings taken inside that cave. They were astonishing. Polychrome cave paintings. Quite vulnerable, as you can imagine, but they were polychrome cave paintings of things like bison, horses, mammoths, as well as other animals, all of which date from about, hang on to your pew, 17,000 years ago. 17,000 years B.C. Stunning. Stunning. They were almost of Michelangelo quality. Magnificent painting, still rich in detail and color, dating from so very long ago. For a simple person like me, as a Latter-day Presbyterian minister, even the antiquity of our Christian faith and religion and its Hebrew heritage seems, well, to kind of fade a little bit. And so I ask myself, but how life and the world have changed over the course of the last 19,000 years from then until now? And how much more is it going to change in the next 300 million years in the life of our universe, give or take a few? Brings me right home to Jesus. Jesus, this morning, according to the John's Gospel in the New Testament, did something that I think is absolutely stunning. Jesus offered the people what? Life forever. You see what he says? Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, he said. Moreover, his conversation, his discussion with all of those bystanders, some 5,000 people, started all with the issue of feeding. And when people heard about the bread of God, which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world, well, naturally, they all wanted a piece of it. And then Jesus explained, I am the bread of life. And whoever believes has, get this, eternal life. You know something? Maybe there's a clue here to what's going on, to what's really going on. It seems to me, if you're not so sure about wanting to live forever, perhaps there is a helpful clue right here in John's Gospel. And this is what I have discovered. Eternal life, to me, is not the same thing as everlasting life. Has that thought ever crossed your mind? Eternal life is not the same thing as everlasting life. And when you think about it, everlasting life is just that. Everlasting. Almost, we could add, interminable. But eternal life is timeless. Timeless. Something not subject to the limitations and ravages of time. I would venture to say an experience that can start at any time at all. And it's characterized at its best by experiences of truth, of beauty, and goodness without limit. It seems to me what we might couch otherwise as the fullest experience of being with God here and now, and as the word implies, for all eternity. Do you see what I'm saying? Eternal life is not the same thing as everlasting life. I've noticed, in fact, there's a commodity that we haven't even considered up to this point, and that is the whole issue of love. There's a love poem which is revealed to us in the pages of the Old Testament scripture. And interestingly, the love poem, this portion of the love poem appears in something called the Book of Psalms or the Song of Solomon. Have you ever read the Song of Solomon? You haven't read the Song of Solomon? Wow. Excuse me, Lord. It is hot If you've ever read, again, forgive me, Lord, Playboy magazine, the Song of Solomon is hot, and it's right there in Scripture. In the middle of the Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verse 6, the verse says this: "Set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is strong as death, passion fierce as the grave." This is talking about love between two people. Two people. But if this love is strong enough, if this love is strong as death, what more might be true of the other kinds of love? Bear in mind, this is all related to the one who created us as Adam and Eve. There is plenty of evidence in the Bible for such love representing divine love, God's love. Love that is between God and God's people, and therefore love between God's people as well. So that indeed God's love is intended, I believe, his love is intended to be even wider than that between God's people, because the command to the Jews, reiterated by Jesus in chapter 6, was to do what? To love your neighbor as yourself. To love your neighbor as ourselves. And we know, we should certainly all know by this time from Jesus' story of the Good Samaritan, how widely embracing the love of neighbor was to extend. Remember the story of the Good Samaritan? That love was extended to the outsider, the ne'er-do-well, the one that everybody else, you know, thumbed their nose at. That's how far God's love is supposed to go. Thus it has occurred to me in my small brain, every element of love, however tiny, whether of kindness, generosity, forgiveness, every element of kindness becomes part of the great accumulation of love in the world. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Jesus promised. Whoever shares in his life will live forever. Not visibly or tangibly, but as part of the timeless accumulation of love that is handed down from one generation to the next. How does all this begin? I'll demonstrate. Good morning, Pam. Welcome to Trinity Presbyterian Church. It's so nice to see you and to have you with us this morning. My friend, Wayne, it's so nice to see you this morning. Welcome to Trinity Presbyterian Church.
Nice to be here.
It is a pleasure. What about those cards you write to your friends and neighbors? Prayer cards? Wishing them well, praying for them? Little notes of kindness? Little expressions of love? Celebrations of birthdays, anniversaries? That's how it works. So that over time, you have this accumulation of love from generation to generation. How long has Trinity Presbyterian Church been here in this time and place? All because, I would submit to you, because of something called love that's been handed down from generation to generation. It's timeless. Do you see what I'm saying? This brings me right back to my favorite magazine, the National Geographic History Magazine, and that cave in France, 17,000 BC, with the magnificent polychrome paintings on the ceiling. It took a little cooperation 17,000 years ago among families to create those paintings. Families who obviously looked at their world, albeit a little more primitive than ours, but who looked around them and cared for one another and saw that something needed to be expressed and preserved 17,000 years ago. So again, I ask you, do we want to live forever? Well, naturally, the response is, of course, yes, we all want to live forever. And yet for others, the answer might possibly be, no, I don't want to live forever. Probably no, on the basis of those anti-aging drugs I mentioned to you earlier, keeping us going forever as we begin to fill the world around us to overflowing to the point where we need to send people to the moon and to Mars and other places just so we have enough space to live. But perhaps yes, on the basis of what Jesus promised. Look at the scripture. Jesus said, he himself is the bread of God, which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And whoever believes has eternal life by identifying with Jesus. We share in his life-giving, which is the sharing of love. And even we begin to see as we share our life with him, we begin to realize our smallest contributions, our littlest contributions count. Remember the widow's mite? The widow's mite in the New Testament? That woman had nothing, and yet she gave everything she had to God. Even our littlest contributions count, and count right alongside the self-giving love of Jesus himself. And that, my friends, I reckon is how we live forever. Oh, of course, maybe with ourselves forgotten with the passage of time, but yet continuing to live forever by our invisible contributions to the accumulated mass of love in the world and held beyond time in the real but incomprehensible love of God. I commend Trinity Presbyterian Church for something it took action on just a week or so ago. Our session voted to donate, to contribute, to lend a hand to the people in Asheville, North Carolina, who have just lost everything. And although, compared to the rest of the devastation and the rest of the cost involved, it might not be a huge donation, it was a contribution, a signal, a sign, evidence of God's love. That's divine love in action. And I commend Trinity Presbyterian Church for taking that action. And I pray that we all be caught up in that kind of love for the rest of our days. Amen. Dear friends, if you will, turn with me to our communion hymn for the morning. It is entitled, Let Us Break Bread Together, selection number 513 in our blue hymn books. Good friends, this is the joyful feast of God which is before us this day on this worldwide communion Sunday, where many, many people around the face of God's world will be gathering before this table. This is the Lord's table that is before us, and he invites all who trust and believe in him to share the feast that he has prepared for us at this time. We will recall on the night of his arrest, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the like manner, on that same evening after supper, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ took the cup, saying, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood. Do this, remembering me. And so at this time, I cordially invite our elders to come forward. Thank you. Jesus said, "He who comes to me will never be hungry." My dear friends, take now the bread of life and eat ye all of it. Again, I cordially invite our elders to please come forward. Jesus also reminds us, "I am the vine and you are the branches. Cut off from me, you can do nothing." Every time you eat of this bread and drink of the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes again. My dear and good friends, take now the cup of the new covenant sealed in the blood of Christ and drink ye all of it. Let us pray. In this sacred moment, and what we observe is Worldwide Communion Sunday. Dear Lord, we, your children of faith, gladly, joyfully call upon your name, knowing you to be the one and only God, the living God, the one who promises all of us who call upon your name life eternal. Oh, what joy you have promised to each and every one of us. Bless us with this life more abundant. Bless all who call upon your name and that of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit himself. And at the same time, we pray that your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace, will indeed be looking over your world this day. Oh, peace, peace, dear Lord, is what we most earnestly pray for in this time and place on this Worldwide Communion Sunday. Now, dear friends, I cordially invite you to joyfully, gladly present your morning offerings unto the good Lord's safekeeping. Life more abundant, the good life, eternal life in you. We thank you this day, dear God. Thank you for the many blessings which you have bestowed upon us, the many that surround us now at the beginning of this fall season. What joy, what beauty, what blessings we all have been blessed with. We rejoice that we have this opportunity to offer unto you a goodly portion of ourselves as we have come together on this Worldwide Communion Sunday before your table. This I pray in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. seated. And truly it is a beautiful Sabbath morning that we draw together at this time, on this Sabbath morning here at Trinity. As we come to our prayer time, just a couple of notes I need to share with you. Some of you already know that Mr. Jack Nunn was admitted to Geisinger Hospital this past week after suffering an unfortunate fall that injured both his knee and his hip. He is currently back home at Wesley Village, where he has been receiving therapy from the registered nurses there. Jack is a very faithful soul, and we have all, of course, been amazed how well he's been able to get around. But unfortunately, he suffered this fall. We pray for him, and God's blessing to abide. As I mentioned to you earlier, Karen and I will be taking off shortly after worship this morning to attend a continuing education seminar all the way down in the great state of South Carolina, which is kind of far. I'll have to get my GPS out and my AAA roadmap in order to figure out where this place is, but we'll be down there for a few days, I trust, in a vibrant learning experience, to be able to enjoy a vibrant learning experience. Asheville, North Carolina. I mentioned that earlier as well. If you've been following the news stories by way of the evening news, whether locally or nationally, you know that that French River Valley was virtually wiped out. People lost everything. And at last count, over 200 people that they know of have lost their lives, or did lose their lives in the process. The storm that went through our country at that time was actually twice the size of Hurricane Katrina, which you may recall went through the southern states just a few years before. It was twice that size. The devastation is enormous. And once again, I want to thank our session for thinking of them and willingness to lend a hand in whatever way possible to help those folks get back on their feet. Are there any other prayer concerns? Anything at all? Okay. I'm kind of leaning this way this morning because most of our folks are on this side of the sanctuary. It's sort of like a competition between the north and the south here at Trinity. More often than not, it's on that side, but today it's on this side. So please forgive me if I start leaning this way. Well, let us go to the good Lord. Well, we do thank you for the gift of this morning, this Sabbath morning, dear God, as we, your sons and daughters, have gathered before your table to meditate, to learn, to consider, to pray, to embrace, we trust, the life more abundant, the faith that you give us, the faith you offer to us, to take a hold of your hand, the hand of your Son, Jesus, who is the Prince of all peace, knowing that our life is just begun and eternal life lies before all of us. Oh, what joy, what gladness, what an opportunity to be a part of your magnificent kingdom now and forever going forward. And as we do so, dear Lord, we do pray once again for our church, Trinity Presbyterian Church, for those who might be out traveling our nation's highways today. We pray for traveling mercies. Those who are still on vacation, we pray for them and their safe return. We offer special prayers for Mr. Jack Nunn, who suffered a recent fall. May the nourishing touch of your Son Jesus, who is himself the great physician, abide with him, bless him, and restore him to a sense of wholeness and wellness just as soon as possible. Bless our congregation. Bless all of us, dear Lord. We pray this in the name of Christ Jesus, who taught each and every one of us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May the peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, be with all of you this day, now and forever. Amen. And enjoy your afternoon. Amen.